This morning, I want you to open your Bible with me to the 100th Psalm. Brother Gary read this in Sunday school, and I thought, well, the Lord wants y'all to hear it twice, so some of you. And I love this Psalm. It's my title of my message is Spirit of Thanksgiving. And I know you had a lot of things to be very thankful for. The psalmist says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All new lands. Wouldn't it be good if we just, like even in our psalm service, we just, hey, but forget everybody else around us. Just the Lord. We're here to worship and honor the Lord. And it's good joy being here. You know, you're like me. You'd like to see those pews packed. I certainly would. I just soon preached to thousands as I had 10 or 20, you know, so. But we're here, and we're two or three are gathered together in His name. We're with the majority then. Jesus is here. And He said, there am I in the midst. So we can make a joyful noise. We're going to enjoy the Lord. And then He says, serve the Lord with gladness. Come before His presence with singing. Now, I'm not going to preach all this psalm, but serving the Lord seems to be a real hard thing for some people. I dread it. I dread doing whatever, and all of us have been glad. We'll be glad we even can do it. I'm glad I can get up and walk, and I'm still talk. My grandson says I don't have a problem talking. I said, oh yeah, I do too. If it wasn't for them talking to me, I wouldn't know what to say, and I wouldn't have a word. I'm blessed, and you're blessed to get to serve the Lord. Lord, be glad that we are. We're in a free country. I was talking to one missionary that we used to support back in, I don't think they call it Czechoslovakia anymore, but anyway, back in his homeland, he had his wife, and he said that, you know, they'll arrest you. They would arrest you for preaching in the name of Jesus. And his pastor went in and out of jail a lot because he did. I said, did you preach? Did y'all have like, I call it an underground church, you know, kind of hide? He said, what's that? I said, well, I've heard of it. You know, that in some of the communistic countries, they have church, but they have to kind of keep it quiet. He said, no, we didn't do that. People went to jail a lot, but we got out. We came right out and preached again. And we sometimes knew that they had people in there, you know, I guess they call them like spies or spotters, and they didn't keep them from preaching Jesus, and they would get arrested. And, you know, would you do that? You knew that the law official was in your midst, and you still preach Jesus? You know, we're privileged to be able to come before His present, be glad that we're getting to serve Him. We're privileged to get to even to like the moments they're singing. They're privileged to get to do that. He said, know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that has made us. We didn't make ourselves. You gripe and complain about being born and living in some town because you don't like it. Well, you're blessed to get to live in the United States of America. But He is God. He placed us here. It is He that has made us, it says, and not we ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endureth to all generations. You pass it on from one generation to the other. You know, it's Thanksgiving, we always kind of look forward to that because at least one of those two times or three of the year we get our families kind of get to be together and enjoy one another. But, you know, when we're talking about Thanksgiving, the spirit of it shouldn't be one day a year or a short season, a little short affair. It should be around the clock. It should be every day, every week, every month, every year. There are so many things we should be thankful for that we take for granted. That we, I'm just being having a house that is built in such a way that you can be warm or cool. We take that for granted, you know. A lot of things, you're going to share some of yours, but we take for granted we have a church. You know, sometimes, oh my goodness, ain't going to be but 15, 30 of us, maybe. Hey, it's the Lord's church. I get to go. I said to somebody, next time they say it's going to be ice and sleet and snow, I'm going to be here. I'm not going to call it off again. The other day we called it off, everybody could have gotten it. Here from all around us because the roads didn't have ice on them. They're supposed to have had. And I said, I'm not going to observe the clouds or listen to the weatherman. I'm going to come if I have to be over here praying for those that can't get here. You know, but we have a church that stands for the truth of God's word. We do believe the Bible. And we don't try to twist it to fit you or anybody. We just take it verbatim for what it says. For us, I think that I'm privileged to get to be your preacher. And I think you're privileged to have me as a preacher because I stand for the truth. I was raised up in a church, in a home church where they were taught. And they were taught by other preachers. And, you know, we kind of get into a competition thing like. We're not in competition. We're here to serve the Lord. And to be glad we can. It's a privilege that we get to be taught the Bible. If you had Christian parents, you were privileged. A lot of people don't have a Christian mom or dad. If you have good health, you're privileged. If you're strong enough to do anything, you're privileged. Happiness is a joy, is a privilege to have. You know, all the material possessions that you have, they're blessings. And we have the privilege to know that the Scripture teaches us that God puts His joy in us and we're joyful no matter what's going on around us. But let me just talk to you a few moments about some of the things about Thanksgiving, the season that we explained. Psalm 19. Verse 1 says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth His handiwork. You know, a lot of people don't even, I don't know how they come up with this, but they're atheists. They believe there's no God. You know, David was standing out with the sheep one night. I have no doubt this is when he said, when I observed the heavens, the stars and the moon and your handiwork, and I wonder, what is man that you're mindful of him? Looking at all this beauty that you made, and yet you're mindful of us, you know. The heavens declares the glory of God, and the Bible says the firmament shows his handiwork, you know, the very... He's the master. He made all this beauty for you and me. I think I shared this with you, but Paul and I was on a vacation. We were coming back. We came through New Mexico, and it's like areas that we came through. It's like desert. And we stayed in an RV park, and I forgot the name of the little place. And she, I just kind of woke up a little early. It's daylight enough, I could see. And she was sleeping, and I took my camera, and I went out and walked across what you would say, ugly ground. I took my lens, had a pretty good little scope on it, and I pulled it up, and I'll be right there by my foot was flowers. I couldn't even see them with my naked eye. Little tiny flower, and I got right down on it and took a picture of it. And I thought, God has beauty everywhere if we just open our eyes and look for it. He made the heavens, He made the earth, He made everything. And He's the master of all the beauty that you see. You know, we look at Him, we look at where did He come from? He's always been. I don't understand, don't have to understand all that. But it seems like a mystery in our mind, but He'll explain that to us one day, I guess, when we get to heaven if we need it. I don't think we'll even care. We know we're there in eternity with Him. But, you know, one thing that we sometimes take for granted is this old book right here called the Bible and the message that's in it. And it's so easy for you to come in here and in your mind thinking, I wish you'd hurry up and get it over with. No, it's a message of God's Word that comes right out of here, and we're privileged to have it. That's something to be thankful for. We salute the fact that it's extended. It's not just short. In Ephesians 5:18, it says, and be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. This holidays, you have to really be careful. I pray a lot when I'm on the highway, whether I'm riding or driving. God help me to stay on my side of the road, and please keep those other drivers on their side. You don't even know who you're meeting that has had too much to drink, too many drugs in their system, and they go to sleep, you know, or something, and they come over on your side of the road. You know, when a person's drunk, they don't care. They don't know what's going on around them. If they do, they care less. But He said, be filled with the Spirit. Isn't it amazing that God would allow a verse to have drunkenness on wine in it to show you how that you're to relax and to enjoy being a Christian and care less about what everybody thinks about how you're enjoying the Lord? In other words, be drunk on the Holy Spirit. You don't have to do stupid things. You just enjoy the Lord. It's like being in. I was at the Cotton Bowl yesterday watching Faith Knight's play, and I'm sitting there, and someone taps me on my shoulder, and I look around, and it's a kid that was on drugs, had been, and I let him stay in my house with my boys till I found out. And I kicked him out. I said, you can't stay here. Not like that. His mother even knew that. And she said, I'm proud of you, Brother Earl. I said, I can't allow that around me. I don't want it around my grandkids. He voluntarily submitted himself to some help. And he's packing me on his shoulder. So I told his daddy, I guarantee you, I pray for Jake every night. As a good kid, he played football 1 year, 2 years with my boys, and he stood there. I did hug him. I said, I'm so proud of you. He said, I'm learning a lot about God, Brother Earl. I said, I'm glad to hear that. That's what he said. My life was totally different. He looked so good. You know, I mean, it's just a blessing to see how God can work and change a life to be wanting to glorify God. You know, He said that we're to speak to ourselves, speak to yourselves in psalms and hymns, in spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of the Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ. That's quite a statement there for us. Giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father. Now, some things you think, how can I give thanks? That's pretty hard. Well, God has a purpose. God's working in our lives, and God's with us. You know, the goodwill that we can, you know, give to our fellow man. You can't go wrong. There's people that are hurting that you may just give them a little kindness, a little smile, a little good day. to have their spirits lifted. I was talking to a guy at the football game up at I footballed this last Friday. So I went to Stephenville, played too up at Abilene. Chili gave me a ride. There's a guy sitting in front of us and to just kind of looked like we were gonna lose our game because we're behind with 27.6 seconds by 2 points. And they pulled it out, of course. I really had a lot of confidence in those boys. They really know what they're doing. And this guy, I've been talking to him a little. He says, you know, the Lord, I'd said something about the Lord really good to let us even get to enjoy our grandkids and our kids listening. Yes. And that old gentleman got up and left. He said, God bless you, brother. Isn't that a better way than being cursed out because of being ugly to somebody instead of just showing a little kindness? One time I was driving and a truck driver was cussing on the CB. And I said, you know, you don't really have to talk like that. He got worse when I said that. I said, you really don't have to talk like that. There's people listening that trust you truckers to help them to know what it's like ahead, or, you know. And we trust you. And he said, you know, talking about you blank four-wheelers, you hold up traffic. I said, well, I'll tell you one thing. I never have held up a trucker. I've pulled my car over and slowed down so they could go on. Now, you might not get treated good because you're so ugly talking to people. Did you know, not long, I saw a sign on the back of 18-wheeler that said, let's clean up our language. I thought, wow, that's good. I wish they would, all of them. They don't have to be ugly. They can be the most helpful people out there because they know everything going on those highways. You know, we can show a little goodwill, can't we? We can kind of be nice and greeting people instead of being ugly. When you go through at the counter to pay out, I've seen people get on those girls. I wanted to tuck them up by the collar and say, lady, wake yourself up. That girl only getting paid probably $8 an hour to put up with you. You know, some people are so ugly. Instead of being nice, they want to blame the worker for what's going on when they're just getting paid to do the job. All we have to do is just embrace them a little bit with some kind words and then watch them. God challenges you to just try to look to see what their name is on their tag. And if it's turned around where you can't see it, I challenge you to say, you know, I wish I knew what your name was. They'll turn it around and say, oh, some of them you've never heard. Say, oh, that's a pretty name. I'm glad to get to know you. And then leave, say thank you, and call their name for waiting on me. And watch them. People are hungry for a little kindness in this world. They're treated like dirt. Stomped on. And then third, the satisfaction that we enjoy. We have a lot to be thankful for. Philippians 4:6 says, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer, supplication, and thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. I don't know what all God has for my plan of the remaining part of my life, but I know it's abundance. He does things in such a great way for us. We just open our eyes and watch Him. The happiness that just abounds in our life. All around us, help, people willing to help. I said this jokingly the other day, but it's true. I mean, it's just a matter of fact. I have a cane, and if I don't wear my cap so they can see my hair good, I get a lot of help. I'm not asking for it. They're just like to help an old man with a cane. People are kind, and I had two girls hold my arm and help me walk down steps at a ball game because I'm old and I got a cane. And I don't think that as a privilege that they care enough to do that because they don't have to. I didn't fall. And I'm very cautious of that right now, going down steps without a rail. Lord help me, just help me not to make a mistake and step wrong and fall. Hey, there's a lot of people out there that likes to show a little kindness if you let them too. How about getting the privilege of getting excited? Colossians 3:15 says, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts. That's an exciting thought. To the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom and teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And this is something we need to listen to. And whatsoever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. In other words, it doesn't hurt to really get excited, does it? To, man, listen, I've been shut down. My good cook, when she left out of my house, I mean, I am not a good cook. But I have learned how to survive. Thanksgiving, there was three deals of rolls. And she just put them in the oven and cook them. And they were left. And someone told me, if you'll just take those and break them open and put a little butter on them, they're pretty kind of pre-cooked about. And put the broiler on and then get you some cinnamon. I like honey. And I just take a couple of those and put a little honey on that, and that is a meal. Hey, let me tell you what I'm trying to say is we got a lot of food. I think the things to be thinking about when it comes to food. And I can tell you, when they let me eat with Paula, that was really good food. I don't care what anyone says. You got a bunch of dummies in the world that don't realize what a blessing it is to get set at the table and eat good food. I went in that kitchen because those ladies worked hard up there preparing that food. And I hear those people at work there rapping at them about, you didn't cook this way. And I thought, why don't you get in there and cook it? You know, that'd be my statement to them. They come in there griping like that, and they've done all they can do to try to prepare a big meal for all the people and then fix it exactly so all of them can't eat it. I went in and I said, if you let me, I'll hug all your necks. That food was so delicious. Makes me want to cry, folks, because people are so ungrateful to people for what they're trying to do and being helpful. We can be so happy if we had a plate of food. Or to have our family around us. I certainly enjoyed mine. But as I said, I saw all my grandkids, except the two that don't live here. And I enjoyed my family. Just getting to be together and giving thanks. It's a privilege. What about the things that we're successful in, that we'd be thankful for? 1 Thessalonians 5:18 said, and in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. That'd be a good verse to memorize. And that'd help you to be thankful. Because God says it's the will of God in Christ Jesus. In everything give thanks. Possessions that we own, my boy had moved out. And all three of them, when they moved in, they said, "Now, Grandpa," and isn't it amazing how they figure they're going to outlive you? That when you die, this is my bed. I said, "You don't have to wait till I die. Go ahead and get the truck and move it out and take it with you now." "No, Grandpa, we don't want to go yet." "It's okay, but when you leave, you can have it." So all three of them moved out. All three of them got a bed, and I wound up with my bed. And I'm redoing it. I got two other beds that I'll make in the cheapest way I can to put back. So if I do happen to have a company, that place to sleep. So it's a blessing, though, to have possessions. I would open the drawer where you keep the silverware, and it gradually is disappearing. The boys, I said, "That's Grandma's spoons. I want you to bring them back. Where you got them? In your crutch?" And they showed up. Careful of my word. But now I got a whole drawer full of silverware, and I don't know where it came from. I didn't buy it, but it sure is good. Plenty of it. So many possessions that we take for granted. It's ours. Yeah, you've seen that advertisement, that little kid got this deal, that's mine, and that one's mine, until I get to the car. And I guess it's the dad trying to open the door, and the guy said, "That's mine." Yeah, well, a lot of things we have is ours, it's mine, and I'm privileged to have those possessions. Are you glad you get to live where you live? Oh, you wish you lived somewhere else, maybe, but at least you got some place to live. How about the good things or principles that we observe? About the salvation that we have experienced. You look back to that moment in time when you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior. And Colossians 1:12 says, "Giving thanks unto the Father which hath made us meet." The word "meet" means fit to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in life. Saved. Saved from the power of sin, the penalty of sin, the power of sin, and eventually from the very presence of sin. No more punishment. Saved from Satan's power and supported by the scriptural promises that God's given us. And last, now you're perking your head up. We're ready to finish your message. The Savior that we exalt. My, what a thankful heart we ought to have for our wonderful Savior. Revelation 7:12, he said, "I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with black robes and palms in their hands, and cried with a loud voice, saying, Salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne, and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne, and on their faces, and worshipped God." You're not going to be in that crowd one day. For those of us that don't have the best of voices to sing, we'll have it then. And we're going to be able to join in. And we're going to be there with them saying the same words that they sang. Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen. And gratitude and praise. We have a real privilege of being children of God. It's a privilege to live with godly people, people that love Him, that use the abilities that God give them. One of the things I do not take for granted is a man that will come 42 miles and lead us in singing. And I pray to God that he knows that we love him and we're proud of him, that he helps us. And Jim is just always there. Every single time I call him, he just helps me. I try not to take advantage of him, but he's my help. He's a right hand to me. And you ladies don't know what you mean to this preacher. We're very blessed to be a part of God's plan and worship and service. And let's not give up. Just stand and we ask Gary to come to have an invitation. If you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, today is the day of salvation. He died on that old rugged cross just for you. You know, he had to be born in this world to be a part of us so he could die for us, that we might be able to be born and enter into his world. So I ask you this morning to put your personal trust and faith in him, believing from your heart that when he died on that old cross, he was dying for you to pay your hell for you so that you can have eternal life. I'm asking you to receive him as your Savior.
Page number 85.
The very first.